This is a really tiny steam engine. It's about 4 million times smaller than a typical car engine by cylinder volume. I made this engine using manual machines only, and some of the techniques I'm going to show you in this video were traditionally only used in the watch industry. This is a larger version my wife Hazel made several years ago, and it works in the exact same way. Steam or compressed gas is injected into the inlet, where it flows into the cylinder. This pressure increase pushes the piston, which is connected to the flywheel. The cylinder is allowed to pivot, so the cylinder port becomes aligned with the exhaust port in the engine body. The flywheel keeps going and pushes the excess gas out of the exhaust before the cylinder then realigns with the inlet and the cycle starts again. This engine design is called an oscillating steam engine, and you can even run them with a bicycle track pump. Although these engines are simple, there are challenges that we need to overcome when we scale it down. Even simple parts are difficult to make, but with some thought, we can address these challenges with design. For example, here I'm making the piston, but I've designed the piston to be integrated into the conrod. This eliminates the challenge of joining the piston and the conrod if they were made from two separate parts. The piston slides within the cylinder, so let's make this part next. In this case, the cylinder is actually cuboidal, so I get to work machining the cuboid from this piece of brass bar. Normally, when we machine cuboids, we use a milling machine, but there's two reasons why at this scale, it's better to leave the part in the lathe. The first reason is all about tolerances. As we scale down a mechanism, tolerances become more critical. Every time the component is moved from one machine to another, or is unclamped and reclamped, we get an error. If we do this several times, these errors accumulate, which at this size we just cannot afford. The second reason is that it's easier to fit a microscope to the lathe than the milling machine, at least for my machines. The microscope makes jobs like this a lot easier. This 300 micron hole I'm setting up to drill here is the porthole you may remember from the animation at the start of the video. The position of this hole is important to get right to make sure it aligns with the inlet and exhaust holes in the engine body. To get this correct, I take extra care in alignment. I use a combination of methods, including two microscopes and precision gauge blocks, to get it as good as possible. Once aligned, I drill two holes in the side of the cylinder. The porthole goes all the way through into the cylinder bore, and the other one is blind. My intention here was to thread this to screw in a pin to act as a pivot. I now drill the cylinder bore. This is a view under the microscope. I had to use a piece of wire to remove a burr, which you can see is partially blocking the hole. It's actually not very easy to see here, but hopefully you can observe that the hole now definitely goes all the way through. It's a good idea to confirm these things before moving on to the next stage. I ground down this small tap to cut the thread in the blind hole. Unfortunately, this is where things started to go wrong. Rather than cutting threads, the tap just mangled the hole, so I opted to open the hole out with a small end mill mounted in the tapping fixture and then try press fitting a pin. I initially wanted to avoid this because the hole gets very close to the cylinder bore and I didn't want to risk deforming the cylinder bore. Having said all that, I seem to get away with it. I press fit the pin using the watchmaker's staking tool, which is basically just a device for holding the punches vertically. I used a drop of retaining compound for added security. The main body of the steam engine is another challenge. We could use a similar process to the cylinder, but it's thinner, so there's a risk of the workpiece deflecting during machining. Fortunately, we recently acquired a new machine that we can use to make this part. It's called a pantograph machine, and is traditionally used for engraving, but we can use it for machining parts too. It works like a normal milling machine, but the cutter can be translated in any X, Y direction by moving a stylus connected to the spindle through a linkage mechanism. Let me demonstrate why this is useful. First, let's 3D print a template, but I scale it up so it's 10 times bigger than the final part. I then bolt it to the copy table to use it as a reference. This pantograph can be adjusted to work with a wide range of scale factors, but 10 to 1 is a nice ratio to use. I begin with drilling the 0.3mm inlet and exhaust holes. For this, I use some carbide drill bits, but here I encountered a problem. I'm making this engine body from annealed tool steel, and the drill bits kept wandering at about halfway. And considering these holes need to be accurately positioned, this just won't do. So what's going on? Looking at this drill bit under the microscope, it became apparent that the cutting edge had become completely deteriorated. I took one of these drill bits and did some light drilling with it before putting it under the scanning electron microscope to try and understand what's going on early in the failure process. From this you can see brittle fracture surfaces and not abrasive wear, which is preferable. My first thought is that the spindle speed is not fast enough, but I'm running at about 15,000 RPM, which is the limit of my machine, so I can't do much about that. You can see a bit of a built-up edge, which I could probably reduce with cutting fluid, but I think this should lead to adhesive wear and not the brittle fracturing we're seeing here. I'm going to save the technical details for our Patreon page, but I will say that micromachining is not just downsizing normal scale processes. Tool stress increases in a non-linear way at smaller scales. This makes the already fragile carbide tooling susceptible to damage. High-speed steel tooling is less prone to brittle fracture, but can plastically deform under the high stresses experienced with micromachining. The result of this is a narrow band of usable parameters, and this often requires experimentation and mistakes to figure out. Thankfully, I managed to find techniques that the drill bits could survive, but unfortunately I was so focused on successfully drilling these holes that I completely forgot the inlet should have been a blind hole. Oh well, let's look at milling on the pantograph and worry about this mistake later. This is the stylus we will use to follow the template. It's exactly 10 times bigger than the diameter of the cutter. I trace around the template with the stylus while gradually increasing the depth of cut until we break through. I love this approach because you don't even need to see the component during machining. I can perform all my drilling and milling operations on the 3D printed model and by reading the table feed dial. I remove the parts from the pantograph and set it up on my precision drill to form the opening for some tiny brass tubing. When we get onto the engine test, this is where I will feed in the compressed gas. To correct my mistake earlier, I drilled this hole deeper than originally planned so the tube could block off one side. I then just drilled through the other side of the tube so the air could flow from the tube through the inlet and into the cylinder without leaking out of the other side. The cylinder is held against the engine body with a spring. The spring provides enough force so the cylinder face can seal against the engine body, but not so much that the engine runs with excessive friction. I use the finest grade piano wire I could buy, and then wind this by hand in the watchmaker's lathe. The crankshaft converts the reciprocating motion of the piston into rotation of the flywheel. I begin by machining and burnishing the axle. This burnisher is made from sapphire, which is much harder than steel. The burnisher work hardens the surface, which is useful for pivots or bearing surfaces like this axle. I part off the component and reverse it in the collet to face it to size. Now I drill an offset hole to accept a pin. This offset is important to get right, because if it's wrong, the inlet and outlet holes won't align properly with the cylinder port. To set this up, I use a centering microscope in the headstock. This is a good way to accurately center the drill, and then I can accurately traverse the drill using the machine dials. I make the crank pin, and because I can't measure bores this small, I have to use some trial and error to get the fit on the conrod and crankshaft correct. It needs to be a nice loose fit on the conrod and a press fit in the crankshaft. This requires some tweaking with the tapered broach. Once I'm happy, I part off the pin and mount it in the lathe in reverse to remove any burrs from parting off to make the assembly process easier. I used the staking tool to fit the pin into the crankshaft, but unfortunately my overzealous hammering resulted in me bending the pin. A few swear words later and some off-camera work with some tweezers under the microscope, and I think the part was salvaged. The crankshaft is designed to press into the bore of the flywheel. The flywheel is a relatively easy part to make. On large engines, it's traditional to make a flywheel with spokes or holes, and the reason for this, other than aesthetics, is to increase the moment of inertia to mass ratio. On large engines, this reduces the amount of material required to cast the flywheel and also reduces the bearing stress. In my case, I want to maximize the moment of inertia because engine friction becomes a dominating consideration at this scale. If the flywheel can't overcome the friction of the engine during the exhaust phase, or when the piston isn't getting a push, it simply won't work. We could, of course, just make the flywheel larger, but that undermines the goal of miniaturization. I did still machine a groove to form a rim and hub, purely for aesthetics. Assembly begins with press fitting the flywheel to the crankshaft to form one sub-assembly, and then fitting the piston into the cylinder to form another. These two sub-assemblies fit together and are held together with a spring. I quickly make an adapter so I can screw the air compressor onto the engine. Compressed air is a convenient way to test these engines, and if it runs on air, it should run on steam. So let's see what happens. It works surprisingly well and sounds a bit like an obese mosquito. I've edited down the volume of the engine because in reality it's very loud and annoying. But I'm actually very impressed with how much power this little engine has. You can hear it slows down only slightly when I push these stiff toothbrush bristles against the flywheel, which might not seem very impressive, but suffice to say the engine is capable of generating excess power that I believe could have real-world applications where microelectric motors can't be used. Now this is quite interesting. If I hold the tube with my fingers, you can hear the engine slows down. I have a couple of theories, but I think this is most likely because my fingers are damping the elastic vibration of the tube. This means that energy is lost due to this damped behaviour. Interestingly though, sometimes it speeds up when I squeeze the tube, so I guess there are some resonance effects at play too. In fact, you can see this rather violent resonance when I reduce the pressure to around 1 bar. This is a real-time FFT, which is essentially a graph showing frequency on the x-axis. You can see a clear peak at 700 Hz. Assuming the noise is caused by the exhaust, if we multiply this by 60, we get the speed of the engine, which is 42,000 RPM. I think this makes it the fastest rotating thing in the workshop. For those of you who fancy making one of these engines for yourself, drawings are available on our Patreon page. Our Patreon also features extra content such as the making of this mechanical counter. If you would like to help support future projects like this, please do consider subscribing to our Patreon page, the link's in the description. Thanks to those of you who have already subscribed, this will really help us constantly improve our videos. See you in the next one.